We're here in the Space Station Flight Control Room, and joining us here at the PAO console is Astronaut Mike Hopkins. He's one of our newest astronauts, just wrapped up 2 years of initial training, and has actually transitioned. You're one of the first to have a mission assignment. You'll be a flight engineer on the International Space Station coming up in about a little over a year and a half.
Almost 2 years.
So tell us a little bit about the training experience so far.
The initial training, there was a lot more of it than I initially anticipated, and the diversity of it as well. You're doing a wide variety of different activities throughout the training, from learning another language to flying in T-38 jets to operating robotic arms to learning the systems on the space station. And I think for me that was very challenging because every day you were having to focus on something a little bit different, which required a little different skill set. And so you had to work your way through that.
And you've come, you know, your path, you've had a lot of diverse training experiences already, and not all of it's been easy. So it's really quite something to hear somebody like you saying that it's been more than you expected.
Yeah, I grew up in the Air Force, if you will, and I had the opportunity to test airplanes and to manage test programs and acquisition programs in the Air Force, and all of those required different skill sets as well. But as much as that prepared me, it still was quite a bit of work here through the initial training.
So tell us a little bit, what evolved to become your most favorite part of the training? Was there a particular aspect that you really found intriguing or of a particular interest?
Yeah, one of the things that I've enjoyed the most has been the EVA training in the Neutral Buoyancy Lab. I find it very exciting. It is very challenging, though, when you get into the suit and you get into the water and trying to operate in that environment. It's just very exciting. And yet, at the same time, I found it a lot harder than I anticipated. When you see the astronauts in space that are working outside the station, it looks so effortless. And when you actually get in the suit for the first time and are working your way through that, going through the procedures, you realize, wow, this isn't as easy as they make it look.
That's one of the things I think is kind of challenging about everything we do here at NASA. So much work goes into it that it looks easy, but really when you get down to it or we're experiencing it personally, there's a lot of work and effort that goes into that.
Absolutely, and I think one of the things that we don't see often is the thousands of people behind the scenes that make all of that happen. When we are in the suit out at the MBL, I mean, there are tens to hundreds of people that are helping to support that activity, make sure we're safe, make sure that all the setup is correct for simulating what we're trying to do. And those challenges, I think, go unnoticed oftentimes.
A lot of unsung heroes behind the scenes there. And tell us, actually, this is a really good example. We actually saw some activities earlier this week with Joe Akaba and Koichi Wakata in the Neutral Buoyancy Lab. But tell us, you know, when we see them in the pool rehearsing the spacewalk, even at that point, even though that's practice for on-orbit EVA, really you guys have done a lot of work and preparation even to do that rehearsal. What all goes into even doing an MBL run?
Oftentimes you start out with activities like that in the classroom. And so some of the first things we'll do is we'll sit down and we call it a 1G prep for it, where the person that's test conducting that activity will go through the procedures, the activities that we're going to do, which ORUs are we going to swap out, who is going to play the role of EV1, who's going to play the role of EV2, what tools are we going to use. And so it's a very detailed review of what's going to happen under the water.
And when you're in the suit, I can't even imagine being in a replica spacesuit that's going actually underwater. That had to be kind of a surreal experience in itself.
Yeah, and in fact, I'll even go before that. One of the first things we did in the initial training, and before you even get in the suit, is we would dive in the MBL. And the first time I stuck my head underwater was just an amazing experience. Of course, there were operations going on. There were other astronauts in the suits that were practicing their EVAs. And you hear all of that over the comms, and you see all of that activity. And it just, you've got this respirator in your mouth, but it brings a big smile to your face anyway.
Were you already scuba certified?
I was already scuba certified, yes. But it's certainly special to get to go scuba dive in the MBL as well.
Yeah, and for our viewers who aren't familiar, the MBL is the Neutral Buoyancy Lab. It's a large pool here as part of the Johnson Space Center complex, and it's a 6-million-gallon pool, but it's got the replicas of the modules. That had to be awe-inspiring to be underwater, seeing all of that, and maybe bring another depth of reality to your training of what you were doing.
Absolutely, but at the same time, you're pinching yourself because you can't believe you're actually in the pool getting to do this type of work, these types of activities.
We've obviously watched a lot of spacewalks here during missions. What do you think was the most surprising to you about what was hard? I've heard some astronauts talk about, you know, just the resistance of the suit itself because it's pressurized. Were there some aspects like that that really struck
out? Yeah, I would agree with that. That was what surprised me the most was how you had to work through the range of motion of the suit, because you know there's things you just can't do with the way the suit is built, and so you have to learn those things. And sometimes you run into resistance when you're trying to reach out and grab something, and you've got to move your arm in a different way to get it there. And so yeah, that takes some time to get used to it, just to adjust to the suit itself.
Your class is one of the first that has done a bit of modified training flow to better prepare for long-duration missions versus the shuttle missions of the past. And I know one of the big transitions has been more skills-based training versus specific task tape training. You don't have anything to compare that to necessarily, and you've made it through the EVA training, but you know, can you speak to the skills-based things, how long that takes, or the different types of training you're encountering?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, that was kind of how our whole initial ASCAN training was set up as well. We're doing a lot of just very generic training, whether it was on the robotic arm, whether it was with the space station itself, EVA. And as I've moved into training for an expedition, it's a lot of the same activities. And so you don't oftentimes get any kind of specific training until very close to your flight, when the schedule starts to solidify as to, say, what vehicles might be visiting while you're there, or what kind of maintenance activities you might be doing while you're up there. And then you may get some time where you're doing some specific training. But most of it, like when we are in the MBL, is oftentimes just going through, hey, here's the potential procedures you may see while you're on orbit. And so we just try and prepare for any of those contingencies so that we're ready to go when they do happen.
That was going to be my next question, is to compare how the initial training has been different from the mission training you're experiencing now. Imagine there's even a broader range of types of training that you're experiencing?
There is, and one of the pieces that changes a little bit is the amount of travel that now comes along with expedition training. We do spend a lot of time in Russia and with the other IP participants as well. And so now you're learning the Soyuz systems, you're learning the Russian segment systems in a little more detail than we do here during our initial training. And so I'd say what we see is similar. It's now we're broadening the scope of what we're learning with our other international partners.
So you touched on some of the travel that you've done. Your class, I think, was also one of the first that actually went to visit all the international partner countries. Can you tell us a little bit about
the
international component?
Yeah, we did. The only one that we didn't visit was Russia, but we did go to ESA, we did go to JAXA, we went up to CSA. So the Canadians, the Japanese, and the European agencies, and absolutely great experiences, all of them. Just gave us a broader insight into what it takes to continue to operate the International Space Station and what the partners are contributing to that, and it's quite a lot.
So you've subsequently gone to Russia, I'm sure, more than a few times. What's that been like?
Challenging. It certainly has. Certainly there's the aspect of time away from family and home and all of that. But at the same time, I'm very blessed in the sense that there's been a lot of folks that have gone before me. And so it's a pretty well-oiled machine over there in terms of the training that we're going through. And so I'm certainly benefiting from that. And I think they've made it as, you know, as good and enjoyable as you could hope for.
So how does it feel to now be realizing your dream? You've actually got a mission assignment. You've got a date that you're tracking to.
So I know in my blog I kind of talked about the phone call, and you get that phone call of being selected to come down to NASA as an astronaut candidate, and just how an incredible feeling that is. And I have to say, it was quite interesting when you then get the call into the office to say you've been assigned. That's a feeling that even goes beyond that first phone call, if you will. And so I know it gets used a lot, but you just keep pinching yourself that, is this real? Is this really going to happen? And I think until I'm sitting on that rocket, I may not believe that it's actually going to happen, but it's been a great experience so far.
We're certainly going to encourage people to go to the website and read the blog, because it really was well done and very insightful perspective of your journey and your path to becoming an astronaut and applying. But tell us a little bit about the call, like you said. And I think there's also a lot of a mystery about when people get assigned, how that actually happens. But that's a phone call as well.
Well, the phone call for getting selected to be an astronaut candidate, you know, it's a long process, the selection process that lasts well over a year, up to a year and a half, from when you first send your application in to when, if you're fortunate to be one of those that are going to get a call. And in my case, I actually, when I got the call, it was a message first, because I was out of the office at the time, and so it just said, call NASA. And so now you know, this is it. This is what I've been dreaming about for a lot of years. This is what I've been actively trying to achieve for the past 12 years, and it's going to come down to this phone call. And so I have to admit, I was a little nervous to make the call, because you just didn't know what was going to be the answer on the other end. So it took me a few moments just to gather and collect myself before I actually made that call. For the selection to an assignment, to a flight assignment, that was actually, I just had a meeting with the chief of the office, who was Peggy Whitson, and so she called me in, and she just said, hey, I'd like to assign you to Expedition 37, 38, and it was just this, oh my gosh, this is real.
That's very exciting, and we want to congratulate you as well. You've been through a lot and had a great journey to getting here, and again, we want to remind all our viewers to check out the website www.nasa.gov/flynasa, where you can not only find the recent blog from Michael describing his experience, but also information about our recruiting efforts and the application process and how to become an astronaut.